My name is Carl Cochran. I am father.
I am father.
Back against the wall, head still high. Push through it all, father am I. Lead by example, but still I gotta follow. Value your seeds, let's promise them tomorrow. Forever I stand, it's never to be a bother. Forever I'm man, forever I'm father. Forever I stand, it's never to be a bother. Forever I'm man, forever I'm father.
My name is Alan Irvin, and this is I Am Father. My name is Alan Irvin, and this is I Am Father. And we're here to talk about fatherhood. How you doing, my brother?
I'm good. How you doing, man?
I'm doing well.
All right. Thank
you. Johnny Cochran. No, I'm sorry.
Close. Carl Cochran.
Carl Cochran. Yeah, good to have you, man.
Thank you, bro.
Thanks for coming out. I know that traffic was huge.
Yeah,
you got a lot of stuff going on here in Atlanta at the Reverb. You got that, man, that United game that's we lost by one.
By one?
Yeah, and they had the junior varsity in.
Wow.
I think we was out a few people.
Yeah, I was on set while they was playing, so.
Yeah, making another video.
Make another video.
Vaxxing video, right? No.
That's the wrong guy, too.
Wrong guy as well, right? Okay. Hey, but thanks for coming out, man. I had a pleasure to meet you a few weeks ago at a photo shoot.
Yes.
And you were telling me about some stuff with your son, and I thought it was just remarkable how you turned that thing around.
Yeah.
And took ownership. Mm-hmm. And now you and your son is in a better place. I want you to clear it up for me in my mind. But when I say fatherhood, what does that mean to you?
Fatherhood. It means number of things to me, aside from just being a father. Of course, it's, you know, the journey of a father and the father role to his child, you know, mm-hmm. as far as taking care of them, nurturing them, you know, leading them, help raising them, things mm-hmm. of that nature. But for me, fatherhood is also a brotherhood, a friendship.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, that's what you was telling me.
Yeah,
you and your son is.
Yeah, you know, I feel like when we put separations and titles on relationship, I think that sets boundaries. You know what I'm saying?
Mm.
There's aspects of my relationship with my son, I can treat him like a brother
mm-hmm.
and look at him as a brother. You know what I'm saying? In the bigger scheme of things, spirituality,
mm-hmm.
he is my brother.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? But you know, fatherhood is like I said, brotherhood, friendship. You know what I'm saying? Just every relationship you think you could probably fit in there, just so you know you touch on all the different mediums of a relationship.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm
mm-hmm. saying? So. Yeah. So. I know we were talking about one specific son that, and we're going to get into that in a minute, but how many kids do you have?
Five.
You have five kids. Are they all boys?
No, I have three boys and two girls.
Okay. Mm-hmm. How is the raising girls?
So, raising girls, I mean, you know, like when my daughter was born, my first daughter,
mm-hmm.
I pretty much took care of her. You know, I did all the nurturing, I did all mm-hmm. the Bible making, I did all the, you know what I'm saying? Like,
mm-hmm.
I was used to raising my brothers, so I was familiar with the formulas and the pamper changing. You know
okay.
what I'm
saying? Like, so let's back up just a little bit.
Yeah.
So how many siblings do you have?
Siblings? I'm gonna say five, six. You know, I can count.
Okay, now what are you?
I'm the oldest.
Oh, you're the oldest. Okay, so I can understand you taking that leadership role and that responsibility and maturing, mm-hmm. Probably a lot quicker. But you were the oldest.
Yeah. kind of like my childhood was kind of like snatched a little bit away from me. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I didn't have like the, you know, the leisure of, you know, doing what probably most, you know, children got to do, you know, when I was young. I mean, I got to play and things of that nature, but, you know, mines were like, you know, I got to watch my brothers.
Right.
While my mother work.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? I got to make sure the house is clean.
Right.
I got to cook.
Yeah.
And, you know, I learned to cook at a very young age. You know what I'm saying?
So, how young?
Probably at 8.
So what's the age range between you and your siblings?
So my brother beneath me, I think he's, I want to say 47, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And then your sisters, or your sisters more younger?
They're younger. I have one that's close to my age, but we didn't grow up together. You know what I'm saying? We know of each other. We have the same father.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? But we don't speak much, you know?
Okay.
It was only like on occasion or stuff like that.
Okay. And what's the age range of your kids?
My kids, I have two that's 25.
Okay. Are they twins?
No.
Oh.
Different mother.
Okay. Okay.
I like that one. Nah, but no, they're not twins. Different mothers. I have a 225, 21, a 19, and a 5-year-old.
Five?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yeah, so when you are the oldest, so you had to really take care of all your other siblings.
Yes.
Which definitely prepared you for your kids.
And prepared me for life, man.
Yeah, I can see that. Mm-hmm. I can see that. And what way, then, the obvious, did they prepare you for life, though?
Just, you know, being more responsible, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It's an experience, you know what I'm saying? You know, everybody's different, so each of my brothers were different. I was trying to still find myself.
Right.
While doing the parenting type thing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the journey.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so going back to the initial question, fatherhood, what does it mean for you? When I say fatherhood, what does it mean for you?
It means, you know, raising another young man.
Yeah.
You know, for me to be better, greater than myself, you know, pour into him everything that I know, my experiences, allow him to grow.
Yeah. So you actually had you have daughters as well.
Yes.
Yeah. So it would also include
raising up my daughter.
Absolutely. Raising up your daughter. Yeah. I mean, for me. Raising daughters, man, I just really can't imagine raising daughters, because I feel like, I mean, they will be, and this is an understatement, super spoiled.
Yeah, I started off, well, I don't believe in spoiling my kids.
Okay.
You know, I feel like that's a setup, you know what I'm saying, for a letdown. I do believe in, exposing them to what the finer things and the greater things, but you know, having value for it. You know what I'm saying? When you spoil, a lot of times it's just given to you, and you don't really hold no value to the things that's given to you.
Which is true.
You're expecting it all the time, and you know, in most cases, when you grow up spoiled, it becomes a habit, even in a, you know, as an adult.
Yeah, that's what they know.
Right.
They don't have really the discipline in it.
Yeah.
Question though. Growing up, were you more so taken care of by your father's side or your mama's side, or were they married for a long period of time?
My mother's side.
Okay.
My mother, I'm raised more by my mother. My father left when I was young. So.
How young?
Probably 5, maybe 4, I'm not sure.
So when you say left, do you mean that that was the last time you saw him, or?
The last time I knew of his presence being there. You know what I'm saying? You don't, yeah. At that age, you're not really conscious of what's going on.
So do you know him now?
He passed away, but okay. I got to know him, or, you know, we spent some time, but I didn't get to know him as much as I wanted to. Mm-hmm. You know, I guess from his upbringing, you know, I guess he was just used to just being a man and just doing what he had to do. Mm-hmm. You know, I was trying to build a relationship with him so I could understand, you know, where his mindset was, what his path was.
What age was this?
I was in my 30s.
Okay.
And I, you know, was...
So eventually he came back at some point.
Well, he was around, but it was something like I had to go seek him. You know, mm-hmm, what I'm saying? There was a time like he visited here in Georgia, and he came and visited me and everything like that. And we spoke, mm-hmm, spent a little bit of time, but we still didn't get to really have those conversations that matter. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So
I kind of see it, but I want to ask the question. Your father really wasn't there, like he perhaps should have been there.
Right.
So how did he teach you indirectly? How did he teach you?
Indirectly. What I came to understand was he had a distant relationship with his father. And some similarities from generation to generation, as far as I'm aware of. And just speaking to the sister, you know, she shared some things to me about him, you know, like he's a caretaker, you know, he's been that since he was young. So I understand where I get some of, mm-hmm, you know, that heart, mm-hmm, you know, from. He just didn't have
to be a caretaker.
Right. He just didn't have any direction per se, from what I'm understanding,
mm-hmm,
from the father aspect of things. So when, mm-hmm, you talk about fatherhood, that seemed to be absent in his life.
Mm-hmm.
In turn, you know, absent in my life.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? And so, you know, I just learned from the things that was missing in our relationship to fill in the blanks with in the relationship with my kids.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? You know, just to flip that whole, you know, cycle around.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely, man. I mean, that's why I find it hard to hold your dad accountable for a lot, because you never know what they're going through.
Yeah.
Generational curses is strong.
Mm-hmm.
I'm talking about seriously strong. And the system wasn't set up for us to succeed. Not us. Mm-hmm. You really have to consider that. And I see how he taught you indirectly. Mm-hmm. I mean, you took care of your siblings. Mm-hmm. I mean, you have the mindset now with your kids. We hadn't gotten there too much yet, but I believe if you had an opportunity, let me ask you this. Do you have custody of any of your kids?
No, my kids are older now, you know, except for my 5-year-old, mm-hmm, where, you know, she's pretty much alienated. We're alienated from each other. So
why is that?
I believe from the things of what her mother deals with, you, mm-hmm, know what I'm saying?
What is that?
Well, just from, you know, some of our conversation, I know she dealt with a lot of trauma in her life,
mm-hmm,
you know, relationship with her mother, the missing relationship with her father, some abuse.
So they really have it on both sides, your kids, with
the five-year-old,
uh-huh,
you know what I'm saying?
So the son that you have a pretty good relationship with now that we were talking about, how old is he?
He's 25.
He's 25. Okay. Now, is he local?
No, he's in Texas.
Okay. I tell you, man, I sit here and I listen to, you know, testimonies of fathers, and you really just, you can see how, I mean, things have progressed over the years. You can see how, I mean, we act out in certain ways. But I'm really at a loss for words right now because there's a lot going on over here.
I mean, you know, there is a lot going on. Mm-hmm. And like you said, there are some changes happening. You mm-hmm. know what I'm saying?
Which is a good thing. Let's talk about the 5 year.
Okay.
So the 5 year is local. Is the 5 year local?
No. Honestly, I'm not sure where the 5 year old is. Last I knew, she was in Pennsylvania. Mm-hmm. That was the last time I saw her. That's where she was.
Mm-hmm.
So she has other daughters that she has done this to with their father, mm-hmm. alienate. So, oddly enough, their grandmother is in communication with me, so she just communicated and said, you know, she thinks that my daughter and her mother and them are in Florida now.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, because I'm not speaking to them,
right.
And, you know, I'm not tracking, you know what I'm saying, but it's that type of cycle.
Yeah,
going on that.
Still working on getting her back in the fold.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
from you, what has been, I mean, your toughest challenge as a father with your kids?
I would say most of my challenges with my kids was unraveling the seeds that their mothers planted in their head
mm-hmm.
about me.
Mm-hmm.
One main thing I've experienced across the board with my kid's mother is, you know, the use of the kids as, you know, a pawn,
mm-hmm.
a tool,
yeah.
or a weapon, or, you know, something to kind of like, you know, hold over your head or against you.
About you.
You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
But during that process, if things wasn't good, or whatever the case is, you know, they wanted to speak down.
Yeah.
And so I had to deal with that. You know what mm-hmm. I'm saying? Which I was fine about. You know what I'm saying? Like, I've gotten to a place where I'm more comfortable with life because I know things are gonna come. Things are gonna
get better when they get older.
Definitely. But I think when you're optimistic about that approach in life, you could get to resolves better.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? As opposed to, you know, me talking down about the mother to my kids to get back.
That's not gonna work. Yep.
To balance out what they're saying about. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Like,
because that's what we got to stop. Evidently, it's clear that it's happening on the mother's side,
yeah.
right? And for you to do the same thing that she's doing is not gonna make it better. So I definitely agree with that approach.
Yeah.
And I mean, you got to be humble, and you appear to be a very, very humble dude.
Got to be humble. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? I would like to say, you know, because of my tolerance and my quietness, and, you know, just trying to stay out of the way, you know, that was a level of humble.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, I had to be even more humble. You know what I'm saying?
In what way, though?
Just to take what came with life. You know what I'm saying? Just to accept it without blaming myself or blaming the other person.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? And, you know, even when you do it like that, a lot of time you end up on that journey alone, because there's always that tug of war for who's right and who's wrong.
Yeah.
But when you look at life differently, you know what I'm saying? You know, I could be as apologetic as I want to. I could be as appliant as I want to. I could even, you know, like, for them, now that's ego-driven, because their whole thing is fighting for position. You know what I'm saying? Instead of focusing on what the real idea about this whole journey is.
Yeah. I mean, me not being an expert in the field, but I hear a lot of testimonies, you know, and for me, I think there's a quiet fight to turn this thing around, you know. And when I say quiet fight, I'm speaking of, the goal is to capture the hearts of your kids, right? What does that fight look like to you?
That fight is a transparent fight.
Very clear. That when you say transparent, do you mean it's very clear to them that you are fighting for their heart?
It's clear to them that I am fighting. You know what I'm saying? You definitely have to let them know in that process. One of the things about, you know, the situation with my daughter is, I used to wake up in the middle of the night with my arms folded. Right? This one was kind of like just started going on. And in, like, tears, waking up crying, you know, it was affecting my day, my livelihood, everything. It was affecting everything.
I can see that.
And even to try to get answers, even to try to make calls to people, even to try to cry out to different agencies and people, and be like, look, I'm looking for my daughter. You know what I'm saying? Trying to be my daughter's life. It's like there's no support in that. You know, that's part of the fight too. You know what I'm saying? So once you see all these things happening, you know you're fighting, you know, I'm a praying man, I pray. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, whatever, I feel like whatever I need to do on the end to make the situation better, I'm willing to do. Let it go. Any ego, any pride, any extra thought about it, just so the situation can have an opportunity to grow. And a lot of times that don't even matter. So it forces you back to have to now have that silent fight, which is a spiritual journey. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
That spiritual journey now causes you to have to look deeper inside. What more do I have to do? What am I not doing? What am I missing? And sometimes when you seek that way, there's a revelation and a salvation, because, you know, you're showing God, like, you know, your willingness to work on that part and be selfless and everything. But it's also like allowing that person to grow too.
That person, which is?
The mother.
The mother. Yeah. because the kid's going to remember two things. Going to remember what the mom say and do. And going to remember what you say and do. And so, and being clear with that, every effort you do got to be positive, because
it's got to be positive. Like, and that's what I'm saying. Like, that's the humbling part of it, because you don't really think about it. You think of the aspect of I'm doing good, but sometimes even doing good might seem like you're doing something bad. You know, so if I'm saying, well, I was always there for your mother, but she never cared. You know what I'm saying? Even though I'm just saying I tried with your mother. You know what I'm saying? I did everything for her. And whatever conversation they have, or whatever she might take, because their relationship, she might look at it as, you know, I'm talking down on her mother.
Yeah, I would. I wouldn't even. If it was me, and this is just me, if it was me, I'd leave the mom out of it, right? And it'd be, what am I doing for you? What am I saying for you? Because is that what they're gonna remember? And one day, the prayer is that you've done so many good things and you've showed your heart so many times and in so many ways to that child, mm-hmm. that they're gonna say, ah, well, he loved me. I can't really be sure on what my mom and my dad went through. Mm-hmm. And man, that's I mean, it's a lot of unspokens there.
So you know, like I said, even in, you know, not speaking directly or trying to bash or talk down on my,
right,
my
don't even go there.
No, I mean, it's something I had to learn, that I couldn't even say something good that was seemingly good.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the humbling part about it. So, but then that teaches you that, like you said, okay, let me just focus on her.
The kids.
Right.
Well, your daughter, your little right. daughter, yeah.
But it was a challenge because you see some things that's influenced from the mother, and you're like
yeah.
trying to address it.
Yeah. Well, so, that's going to be hard because she lived
right.
with.
Right. So it's clear. So yeah. you got to be. So that's what I'm saying. There's a whole twist about how you deal with this, because everybody don't have the patience to sit back and be like, okay, you know right. what I'm saying? This is how I have to approach it. I'm gonna say this.
Okay.
Why I say fatherhood is also like a brotherhood is a friend of mine just took his life today.
Today?
Today. Just hours ago. And when I think about fatherhood, I think about aspects of that on two aspects, because I'm a father, but I was a brother to him. So I, sharing that energy of a father to him is, for me, fatherhood too.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? He was dealing with separation and wanted to be with his kids, but didn't know how to address so many different issues that came up with relationship issues and then the kids being there. And he consequently took his life today. And I just, you know, I spoke to him today from the part of fatherhood and being, you know, encouraging him and, you know, just letting him know, like, you know, I experienced the same thing. You know, I'm here. And I'm here to share with you that, you know what I'm saying, there's a lot of possibility for you. You know what I'm saying? And, you know, to hear that he took his life is like a reflection of how I feel about my kids, because then now I look at them and say, what's missing in their lives, so they don't ever feel like, you know, they can't speak to somebody or there's no hope, whatever the case is. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. That's why I say that now the fight with the mothers to me aren't even important, because, you know, I'm looking at life as, you know,
yeah.
more precious.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And a lot of times, even when you're waving the white flag, you know, it's like you're still drawn into the battle. You know what I'm saying? But part of that is like, even where I'm at now is like, you know, just dealing with, you know, self-development.
And that never stops, pretty much.
That's important for, you know, that journey with fatherhood.
And yeah.
That's the thing I share with my kids, like, hey, look, I'm learning. You know, I like to see my kids see me not always in the up mode, so they can say, you know, when my dad was in this place or this situation, you know, he was, so life gotta be good. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Or life gotta, there gotta be some opportunities.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I tell you, man, that's pretty deep. And it's to the point for me where it has nothing to do with the mom. Right now, it has everything to do with how you are in front of your kids. And it's one thing that I appreciate is the effort to keep trying. The effort to continue to sow those positive seeds.
That's all we gotta do, man. And,
yeah.
You know, and I'm glad you're doing this, because, you know, it's good to share the testimonies so other fathers, other men, young grown men, you know, get an understanding of, mm-hmm. you know, the different shapes and
different
textures.
Perspectives.
Right.
Man, listen, one thing that I know is you can't put sin on a gauge. Mm-hmm. You know, so it doesn't matter really what you've done. I know your heart is for your kids and you want your kids in your life. But there are times where we as humans put sin on a gauge, and you can't gauge sin. Sin is sin. And I think what's going to speak louder is every time you communicate with your kids, no matter how that's been done, if they feel and hear your heart, at some point it's going to turn. If God got the heart of kings in the palm of his hand and he can turn it as he want to, what do you think he can do for kids? You know? So I say, brother, keep praying and stay hopeful, and things going to change, man. Things going to change.
You know, my relationship with my kids are great. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, the only one I don't have any communication with is the one that's 5 years old.
Mm-hmm.
But my other kids are, like, awesome. They know my heart.
So it can happen. I mean, right? We're waiting on the 5 year old.
Yeah, I'm waiting on the 5 year old. So, I mean, so God already showed me. You know what I'm saying? He just needed me to not just put all my eggs in the basket with the 5 year old. You know what I'm saying? So my other kids could see me be productive and move mm-hmm. on and not be, you know, played with, you know, what comes with that separation mm-hmm. and the depression and all the attack and the guilt. And, you know what I'm saying? And I'm saying that because I only imagine what my friend was feeling
mm.
because he was expressive, and I kept, you know, every moment I had a chance, you know, I knew what he was battling with that. You know what I'm saying?
What was he battling with?
Guilt.
For not being there?
For not being there here.
Mm-hmm.
Because it was things that he was doing that he come to find out now was detrimental to the relationship that he never thought about. So when he's asking questions like, why is this going on, right? Now it's like unraveled, you know what I'm saying? And it's like a heavy brick. And, you know, you just keep piling it on yourself. And, you know, you keep burying yourself because, you know, I swear, even this morning, you know, when I woke up, you know, the music he was listening to was very low vibrational, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Like, just downing. And he was just blasting it. And it was bothering my spirit.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't nothing derogatory or anything like that. It's just, you know, just a sad song. And so I immediately had to get up, turn my phone on, and blast some affirmations or something positive.
Mm-hmm.
Then he came upstairs and he asked me for 75 cents. I said, bro, I looked at him. I said, bro, you don't need to start your day off like this. What I said to him today. I said, I'll give you money for anything. I said, but he said, you know, I was paid. I said, it's not about paying you back. I said, I don't feel good about giving you money in this situation that you're in for you to do that. Gave him 75 cents. He still went and got a beer. Came back. He spoke to me. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, bro, you know, I just gave him some more encouraging words. He's like, man, everything you're saying is right. He's like, man, you're a very good dude, man. And I love you. And that was the last thing he said to me. You know what I'm saying? Then I go off. I'm on a job. Then I get text messages. And he told me he just hung himself. You know what I'm saying? And, you know, it's... And for me, that's another part of fatherhood, because we got to stop that. You know what I'm saying? Should he have a father in his life or a father figure? You know what I'm saying?
So his father wasn't in his life?
No.
You know anything about his father?
No. I know his mother was, you know, she was visiting at the time. You know, she was staying at the house for a little bit. So, I know, yeah, his upbringing wasn't, his upbringing gave him no hope.
Yeah. But yeah, that's unfortunate, man. I'm really sorry to hear that. I mean, my condolences to you. Because it seemed like y'all was roommates. How long had y'all been friends?
It wasn't very long, man. Just, you know, maybe a few months.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but, you know, I just take that energy everywhere, man. That same nurturing energy, I just take it. I care about people.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? So, that he did, you know what I'm saying? He started to take that route. He tried to pray, you know, he tried to listen to the word. I heard him, you know what I'm saying, time and time again. Yes, we just, as fathers, brothers, mothers, everything, we just have to try to reflect, you know, more of an understanding, you know what I'm saying? Like, you know, sometimes we could just be not understanding, man. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, lack of understanding, I do it every time.
And no compassion, because it's like, you know, now what? You know what I'm saying? Cause now you left your kids.
Mm-hmm.
Now the cycle may ensue. You know what I'm saying? You know, things like that. I try to explain to him, like, man, you know, what will happen? You know, what will be the fate of your kids if you give up?
Yeah. I mean, yeah, yeah. I mean, that's very, very, very unfortunate because, I mean, on one hand, you know, I can understand and I can feel his pain. On the other hand, now there's absolutely no hope because he's gone. He's the father, you know what I mean? And his kids are fatherless.
So that's what I say, man. You know, fatherhood is a whole lot for me, man, because it's a, for me, it's a different type of lifestyle, more open, you know what I'm saying, than just parent-child relationship, you know what I'm saying? It's a reflection, you know, just like the president. Mm-hmm. The president still got to reflect. He's a good father. He's a good community leader. He's a good, you know what I'm saying? It's, you know, that's how I feel about fatherhood. You know?
Yeah, it's tough, man. I mean, God puts a heavy responsibility on a man. The burden is on the shoulders of the man. So, thanks for coming out, brother.
My pleasure, man. My pleasure.
Be praying for you, man.
Thank you.
All right. Appreciate it. Thanks for coming out. This is I Am Father. I do want you praying for my brother here and his friends, family. And like, subscribe, and definitely comment on his video.